So let's discuss a few points on the RDS backups and restore. We will cover this quickly. This is also very important. Okay. So the first thing that I want to tell you, or that's already highlighted, is by default, Amazon RDS creates and saves automated backups of your DB instances securely in Amazon S3 for a user-specified retention period. Okay. Don't worry about this. We will be seeing all the options that we have here in the demo that we are going to have very short while. So let's move on then. So the first thing that we have here is automated backups. It's turned on by default. The automated backup feature of Amazon RDS will backup your databases and transaction logs. And Amazon RDS automatically creates a storage volume snapshot of your database instance, backing up the entire DB instance and not just individual databases. So this backup occurs during a daily user configurable 30-minute period window known as the backup window. And automated backups are kept for a configurable number of days called the backup retention period. And your automatic backup retention period can be configured up to 35 days. So it ranges from 1 day to 35 days. So manually the default is basically like 7 days, and you can switch it up to 35 days as well. And the second point that we have here is point in time restores. You can point your database instance to any specific time during the backup retention period, creating a new database instance. To restore your database instance, you can use the AWS console or command line interface. To determine the latest restorable time for a database instance, use the AWS console or command line interface to look at the value returned in the last restorable time field of the database, for the database actually. So the latest restorable time for a database instance is typically within 5 minutes of the current time. So mostly you will be able to access it using the variable that we have specified. And the next point that we have here is the database snapshot. So the database snapshots are user initiated backups of your instance stored in the Amazon S3 that are kept until you explicitly delete them. And you can create a new instance from the database snapshots whenever you desire. Although database snapshots serve operationally as full backups, you are built only for the incremental storage use. That's very good. Okay, let's jump on to the next one, the snapshot copies. Okay, with Amazon RDS, you can copy DB snapshots and DB cluster snapshots. You can copy automated or manual snapshots as well. So after you copy a snapshot, the copy is a manual snapshot itself, and you can copy a snapshot within the same AWS region, and you can copy a snapshot across AWS regions, and you can as well copy a snapshot across AWS accounts. Okay. And snapshot sharing, that's the next point that we are going to discuss, is using Amazon RDS, you can share a manual DB snapshot or DB cluster snapshot with other AWS accounts. So sharing a manual database snapshot or a database cluster snapshot, whether encrypted or unencrypted, enables authorized AWS accounts to copy the snapshot. So sharing an unencrypted manual database snapshot enables authorized AWS accounts to directly restore a DB instance from the snapshot instead of taking a copy of it and restoring it from that. This isn't supported for encrypted manual DB snapshots. One thing that we need to also remember is sharing a manual database cluster snapshot, whether encrypted or unencrypted, enables authorized AWS accounts to directly restore a database cluster from the snapshots instead of taking a copy of it and restoring it from that. So if you have authority, or you have authorized an AWS account to basically create a snapshot from the manual snapshot that you already have shared, they don't have to take a copy of it and restore it from it. They can do it directly. So now let's discuss Amazon RDS encryption of data at rest. Okay, the first thing you must understand is that this will surely come in the exam, and I have faced questions from this topic. Understand this very carefully. Okay, so the Amazon RDS encrypts your database using keys you manage with the AWS Key Management Service, or the KMS. I hope you remember KMS, which is used to maintain the secure encryption keys that we use for our services. We use the same keys to encrypt the database. On a database instance running with Amazon RDS encryption, data stored at rest in the underlying storage is encrypted, and are its automated backups, read replicas, and snapshots. And RDS encryption uses the industry standard AES 256 encryption algorithm to encrypt your data on the server that hosts your RDS instance. If you see the example visually here, the customer has the keys generated and it's the master key, and each of the data at rest is being encrypted using the unique key that is generated based on the master key. So I'll reiterate this once again. If you see, the customer has the keys generated and its master key, and each of the data at rest is being encrypted using the unique key that is generated based on the master key. Okay, so basically you use the data keys to encrypt the data which is encrypted by its own master key, and this is quite a bit confusing, isn't it? And the third step that we have is we use the data keys to encrypt the data that we have on the database instance. Okay, so what exactly happened here is we have the customer master keys, and from that master key we encrypt the data keys, and that data key is used to basically encrypt the customer data in the RDS instance. Okay, so the first three steps that you see here, the first step, again, I want to reiterate, you create the master keys, okay, the customer keys based on the master keys that you have, and from that you encrypt the data keys, and that data key is used to encrypt the customer data. Amazon RDS also supports transparent data encryption, or the TDE, if you're using SQL Server or Oracle. So you might ask, what is TDE? So TDE basically is transparent data encryption. It is basically a technology employed by Microsoft, IBM, and Oracle to encrypt database files. Okay, so TDE offers encryption at file level, and TDE solves the problem of protecting data at rest, encrypting database both on the hard drive and consequently on the backup media. It does not protect data in transit. And one of the most important things that you need to remember about TDE is it is not used for data or protection of data in transit or the data that is currently in use. Okay, it is always used for the data at rest. So as we have discussed data at rest or the encryption of data at rest, let's go to the interesting one. So data in motion is often considered less secure, and its vulnerability makes it a cup of tea for hackers. If you are unsure or have only heard the term, then it's basically data traveling from network to network, or data transfer from local storage to cloud storage. So in simple terms, it's basically the data that is currently in use. So for this type of data in transit, RDS provides a mechanism that encrypts communication between your application and your DB instance using SSL or TLS. Okay. And Amazon RDS creates an SSL certificate and installs the certificate on the DB instance when the instance is provisioned, so that your data is secure during transit. And you can as well configure this in your clients or the SQL clients that you have. So for MySQL clients, you launch the MySQL client using the --SSL_CA parameter to reference the public key in order to encrypt your connection. And there is a query that I have already mentioned, grant usage on ../ to user @required SSL. So you can use this query to basically have your SSL encryption in place for the data in transit. And for SQL Server that you have, you can download the public key and import the certificate into your Windows operating system, and by this you can as well encrypt the data at transit. Oracle actually uses the Oracle native network encryption with a DB instance, and you can also require your database instance to only accept encrypted connections. So if you're using Oracle, Oracle by default comes with a native network encryption when you have the database instance in place. For Postgres, you can use the command that we have here, is the parameter that you have, or the configuration that you have, is rds.force_ssl=1 in the RDS console. And you can set this parameter so that your data is secure, or the data is encrypted during transit. So one of the major important points when we discuss about security is access control. And this is one of the new features that we have for Amazon, or the AWS services that we have. So Amazon RDS is integrated with AWS Identity and Access Management, that's the IAM, and provides you the ability to control the action that your AWS IAM users and groups can take on the specific resources. So that can be your DB instance, your DB snapshots, your DB parameter groups, or DB event subscriptions, or the DB option groups. And you can also tag your Amazon resources or the Amazon RDS resources and control the action that your IAM user or group can take on the groups of resources that have the same tags and associated value. For example, you can configure your IAM rule to ensure that developers are able to modify development database instances, but only database administrators can make changes to the production database. And let's see this visual example here. When you first create a DB instance with Amazon RDS, you will create a master user account, which is used only within the context of Amazon RDS to control access to your database instances. So the master user account is a native database user account that allows you to log into your database instance with all the database privileges. And you can specify the master username and password you want associated with each database instance when you create the database instance itself. And once you have created your database instance, you can connect to the database using the master user credential. Subsequently, what you can do is you can create the additional user accounts so that you can restrict who can access your database instances. So the first thing that obviously I want or I suggest you to do is create the admin. And then once you have the login in place, then create the user groups or add the users and provide the tags so that you can assign the users to the tags that belong to that production or the development environment or the database instance that you have. Okay, so that you can have a restrictions in place. Otherwise, what will happen is if suppose the developer is testing out some of the resources or some of the queries that they have and it goes accidentally to the production environment, then it might be a huge problem or loss of data that can happen in your application. So the database instances deployed within an Amazon VPC can be accessed from the internet. Yes, it can be accessed from the internet or from Amazon EC2 instances outside the VPC via VPN or bastion hosts that can launch in your public subnet. So if suppose you have your Amazon VPC and you want to have public access, and if you want to have internet access to the database or the Amazon EC2 instances that you have, you want them to be able to access the DB instance, then you can use it and you can use the VPN or the bastion hosts that you can launch it in your public subnet and they can make use of it. And to use a bastion host, you will need to set up a public subnet with the EC2 instance that acts as a SSH bastion. So this public subnet must have an internet gateway and routing rules that allow traffic to be directed via the SSH host, which must then forward requests to the private address or the private IP address of your Amazon RDS database instance. It's not that, clear, but as we discuss along with the lines of VPCs and how we create the public and private subnets, this will be more clear. So AWS RDS proxy is something that's fairly new and it's still in the beta stage or preview state that you might say, but we need to discuss this anyway. So Amazon RDS proxy is a fully managed, highly available database proxy for Amazon Relational Database Service or RDS that makes applications more scalable, more resilient to database failures, and more secure. Okay, if you're confused about what a database proxy is, don't worry. It's like within a context of databases, a proxy sits in the middle between the application and the database. Okay, so it sits between the application and the database. And the application connects to the proxy, which forwards connections to the database. Okay, so as we are tech freaks and the database we set up today in today's time can have a large number of open connections to the database servers and may open and close database connections at a high rate, exhausting the database memory and compute resources, Amazon RDS proxy allows applications to pool and share connections established with the database, and thus improving database efficiency and application scalability. And with RDS or with the RDS proxy, failover times for Aurora and RDS databases have reduced by up to 66%, and database credential authentication and access can be managed through the integration with AWS Secrets Manager and AWS Identity and Access Management. So you can have RDS proxy integrated with the AWS Secret Management and the AWS Identity and Access Management to make sure that you have your database credential authentication and access in check. And the way it works is same way as I explained before about proxy databases. So here as well, the Amazon RDS proxy sits between your application and your relational database to efficiently manage connections to the database and improve the scalability of your application. So yes, we have the RDS proxy, but what can it help us with? So the Amazon RDS proxy instance maintains a pool of established connections to your RDS database instances, reducing the stress on database compute and memory resources that typically occurs when new connections are established. Amazon RDS proxy is highly available and deployed over multiple availability zones. And in turn, what it does is it increases application availability and reduces database failover times. And with the security, it manages applications data security with database access controls. Okay, this was quite informative. Let's move on. So these are some of the points that we need to discuss about the exam point of view for solutions architect. So let's go over them one by one. So the read replicas are used for select statements of SQL and not other statements in the CRUD operations. So you have to remember that select is basically read. So when you talk about reading or read operations in CRUD or the database, that means that the operation that is going to be performed is select. Okay. And insert, delete, and update are other operations which are basically, you can say it as a write operation in the sense of reading and writing. So where select is read and the other things are write. Okay. And Amazon RDS also supports transparent data encryption for SQL Server and Oracle. And transparent data encryption can be used on top of KMS. And once you use this, you must understand that there can be an impact on the performance as well. So make sure you use them wisely. And Amazon RDS encryption uses the industry standard AES 256 encryption algorithm, okay, which is very secure. And Amazon RDS is integrated with AWS Identity and Access Management and provides you the ability to control the action that your AWS IAM users and groups can perform. And the lifespan of an authentication token that you have here is of 15 minutes that you must remember, and SSL must be used while connecting to the database. I hope this was clear, and don't worry about the complicated things that we have here. We'll have a hands-on demo of AWS Relational Database or the RDS in the next chapter. So make sure you watch it, and please do subscribe to the channel, and your likes and comments actually help me and motivate me to make new videos. And we are reaching to the end of the life cycle for one of the patents that we have for Solutions Architect on March 22 this year. Please make sure that you give your exams before that, or if you don't worry about it. There's a few changes that they have made which we will have a discussion on this in length, so don't worry about it. You can give your exams now or later on. So there is no hard and fast rule that you have to give it before this itself. The pattern might change. There may be a few topics that may be added, but there's not a whole lot of things that are going to change. So don't worry about it. So keep watching the channel, hit the like, put a comment, and please subscribe. Until then, signing off.